I'm delighted to welcome Florian Busch here tonight. Florian was all the way from Tokyo, not quite today, but in general, that's where he's situated with his practice, FBA, Florian Busch Architects. And I think it's a, reflecting on how a few words I would say from the introduction, I thought about that particular is this open? There you go. I thought about that particular situation, being German, working in Turkey for 15 years, no less. And of course, it loosely reflects on the Staedelschule architecture class, which sees its students coming from not from all over the place, but from a large number of different countries, finding themselves working then in an environment that is, so to speak, in some respects, in the setting of these forums. And I think this reflects on Florian's situation in Tokyo. I think it reflects on his creative situation over all these during all these years. He graduated from Dallas University in 2001, so his basic education is from here in Germany. He then went to London, studied at the AA, and did a postgraduate program there, DRL. At the time when Red Steel, Patrick Schumacher, and others were teaching there. And he finished in London in 2003, and after one more year there, he went to Tokyo and started to work for Toyo Ito. And that has been, not only presumably, definitely, an enormous influence on his work, but also on his positioning himself in relationship to architecture in Japan. And it has resulted in, since he left then, Ito and Associates in 2008, it has resulted in an impressive portfolio of very beautiful work, a number of smaller houses. This is, of course, in part naturally given by designing for construction in Tokyo, but also cultural centers, libraries, museums, and to all these projects, Florian basically brings an understanding of architecture as an open process, a collaborative endeavor. I suppose, in some ways, something that is required of a German landing in Tokyo, but nevertheless, also something that he almost polemically brought out in public when he, about 2 years ago, ventured with a critique of the competition for the new Olympic Stadium in Tokyo, and made up a secret little package that was sent to his own office with a proposal of a floating alternative floating stadium instead of the one that eventually won the second competition, I believe, yes. Needless to say, all this work has seen him travel to speak as a great guest critic, and he has received prizes such as one from Detail for quite stunning constructive details in his own work. I had the pleasure of first meeting Florian already in 2006 when, in collaboration with Toyo Ito, he did the Tokyo-Berlin-Tokyo exhibition design that was in the National Gallery in Berlin. He was brought in by the engineer Harald Kloft, who was teaching here at the time, and he presented and spoke about his experience of working on that project. Which included a series of transformations which resolved the Mesian absolute space into an exhibition of fluid, active relations. I also believe it is correct that the breakthrough of FBA came in 2011 when Toyo was the chief designer for the Tokyo Design Week. That turned out to be the most successful one of its kind, with some 90,000, more than 90,000 visitors. To the project there, he also brought an explicit interest in culture and space. It was in the aftermath of the tsunami disaster in Japan, and included his engaging in that. And it reflects this positioning of being both inside, that is Tokyo, and its culture, but also outside. Japan Times, in February last year, had a longer piece on Florian, and it says that he is constantly assessing space as related to culture. And in doing so, tries to meld that youthful energy that he, so to speak, inherited from, or at least was inspired by, and tried to emulate from Toyo Ito himself. And parentheses, Florian was one of the few speakers at a larger event celebrating Ito's 77th birthday not too long ago. So he tried to meld that youthful energy of Ito with his own distinct, contemplative perspective. And it was, it said, a role in between, within and without, thoughtfully contemplating space. Well, we're greatly forward to see your work and to hear your speech. Please welcome Flemish.
I'm going to talk about a few things that actually you just mentioned, but the larger picture of tonight's talk is my observations and the way they have, and these are not purely observations from the head, but also a lot of observations from here that have influenced me over the last 15 years. But before we do so, I want to start with something from my childhood. When I was a child, I remember, and it's vague memories, but I remember that at some point I realized that we are always only looking at one side of the room. And I felt quite embarrassed because I felt I was too old to not have noticed this before. But being born, like, I guess, I think it was after the first images of the far side of the room had been sent to Earth, it made me wonder what it must have been for the people who realized that they would never be certain to know what the other side looked like.
Can
I talk louder? Yeah.
Yes,
can you hear me better? Is it better?
Yeah.
Sorry. So, you know, if you think about humanity, like 99% of the lifespan of humanity, we only saw one, so we didn't know that what the other side of the moon looked like. Let alone, there might not even be another side. There was no certainty, at least pre-Copernicus, that there was another side of the moon. And this struck me when I was thinking about this talk and about what really affects me the most during the past 15 years in Japan. And it reminded me of that little story. Because what happened was when these images were sent, all of a sudden I felt that the moon became actually smaller. Because all the magical possibilities of what there could have been on the other side, they were reduced to facts. Now we do. So, in a way, the coexistence of extremes, the visible and the invisible, the known and the unknown, had given way to a now clearly defined object in the sky. Now let's fast forward several decades. And so when I first moved to Tokyo, I noticed an extremely powerful dynamic. And I felt that perhaps one of the main reasons of that dynamic was the permanent oscillating between extremes that I was observing. Now, there are many stereotypes that I'm sure a lot of you have about Japan, and you're thinking about extremes. You're thinking about Zen, Buddhism, on the one hand, everything reduced to pure aesthetics, to the purely essential, and we think about the manga culture or the Akihabara electric town culture in all this. And all of this is true, it exists at the same time. And one stereotype that a lot of people have, and I've often approached it, is the density. And people tell me, how can you live there? It's so dense. And what do you think about it? What do you think about it as an architect? What do you think about it as human beings? I have to remind them that these two are architects are human beings after all. But when we talk about this density, they are of course correct, because that's an image that I can observe on a daily basis. That's a rush hour train. And incidentally, there are the 50 busiest train stations in the world. I think number 1 to 26 is in Japan. And over half of them are in Tokyo. And when we talk about busy, it's that Shinjuku, close to where I live, is 4 million passengers, paying passengers every day. But this density of Japan is heightened by the fact that it concentrates along the coastline. So, as you can see on this image, only about one third of Japan is occupied. So this brings me to this other extreme, that actually two thirds of the country are almost empty. So the stereotypes that I was talking about, they refer to the aesthetic and the spiritual mostly, but I think there's a much deeper context that drives something that I have called the presence of absence. And that's something it's an always tangible presence of a looming absence. Where does that come from, and how does it affect architecture, and how does it affect daily life, and what is it all about? And I think there are several reasons, and we'll talk about them today and link them in some mysterious way to some of my projects. I think it's a the Japanese is, unlike anything that I've ever experienced before, a culture in progress. At the end of the 17th century, the empress, there was only the third empress, and now there's a big discussion that there should be no more empress in the future. The empress of Japan did something extremely striking. She had a shrine deconstructed, only to have an exact copy of it reconstructed right next to it. What would become one of the world's most influential rituals had begun. And little did she have the idea that probably that 1300 years later, this same ritual would still be executed every 20 years. If you think about the culture where you are part of it right now, in this place, European culture. Look at the Parthenon. The Parthenon is a reminder of the height of our culture. In fact, this is, as you can see on the crane, it's a ruin that's being maintained to stay a ruin to remind us of the culture that was once great. An image of an idea, the original, is imprisoned in the past. if you compare this to that kind of understanding, I think it's fascinating how fundamentally different it is. I think this is the shrine, and this is the shrine Gießen. And as you can see, this is the new one. The last rebuilding was 2013, so the next will be in 2033. And you can see there's a transition period where both the old is still there. So that's a 20-year-old building that will be dismantled. And I think that's arguably the most profound and beautiful interpretation of the original. The original is a continuous cycle of deep and reconstruction. And this shrine is therefore an active link between the past and the future. And where the Western philosophy has often struggled to find the bridge between these two, between the original and continuity, if you think about the ship of Theseus as a philosophical puzzle, Issei has effortlessly fused those two. The original is both old and new. And that's a Google image of 2019. So you can see that the building on the right has been dismantled. But for some strange reason, this left side now almost feels imprisoned in the now. And the right side is actually setting it free, because the absence on this other side is indicating the future. The traces of the past that you can still see are indicating the future. So culture is, so to speak, in a permanent state of transition. And these are the shrines. The architecture itself has humble and pragmatic origins, because this is a rice storage of the Yayoi period, which was 600 years earlier than when the Empress did that. And it had to be rebuilt frequently because of the climate in Japan, was very humid, very hot. And the Yayoi were the first culture to become sedentary, the agriculture, and they cultivated rice. So the rice was sustaining the life of the culture. And it had to do so because of the humidity and the damage to the building. They had to rebuild these buildings with seamless continuity. They couldn't afford to have a break in between, because then the lifeline of the culture. So at the heart of Issei's continuity is that kind of the emptiness that happens through the reconstruction. So even after becoming sedentary, I think this culture kept favoring the temporary over the permanent, process over the completion, the openness over closure, and saw in this emptiness a space for opportunity. But there's another very profound reason for this permanent transition, and that's a natural given distraction and the need for regeneration. As I'm sure you're aware, Japan is one of the world's most frequently disaster-affected countries. And therefore, it's both necessary to react after a frequently recurring destruction, and it's also necessary to prepare for the next event. Over 10% of the world's earthquakes occur in Japan, and there's of course a lot of typhoons as well. There's a lot of fires, and if we look at Tokyo, the history of Tokyo is about 400 years, and it has been consistently erased, or vast parts of it have been erased during those 400 years. And this has created an attitude favoring the temporary over the permanent. There's no doubt about that. And during the end of the period, the average lifespan of a building of a house was 7 years. Fires were actually looked upon as not so bad things by the city planners, because they provided opportunity for urbanism. A very cynical thing to think, but that was the reality. So that's just one. If you think 1657, over 100,000 people are killed. 100,000 people at that time. It's just unbelievable. There were hardly any cities of that size in the world. 23, the Portland earthquake, which then destroyed the old Great Wall, like completely destroyed, mostly through fires after the earthquake. And ironically, this is Ginza in the middle of Tokyo, which was completely destroyed by the earthquake because they had, after the isolation 1868 ended, they had imported the technology to building brick, not understanding that, of course, that was good for fires, but it would not withstand the earthquakes. And then we have the war, 1944 air raid, 50% of Tokyo are Iranians by the end of World War II. And something that I witnessed myself is what is in Japan referred to as 3.11, which is the March 11, 2011 catastrophe, where something unprecedented happened. If you think about an entire coastline shifting 90 centimeters, these before and afters are just absolutely mind-boggling to look at. Then in July of that year, I was invited for a workshop with primary school children, and went to the area and I witnessed, I walked. This is a picture that I took in architecture being reduced to toys, flipped over like this. And the only building left is that building where several people survived because of one roof. But I had a workshop with children who, 60% of them had lost their families. But what this creates is a continuity of content, not form. There's a literal necessity of continuity, which is the rice storage, as we've seen. There's the constant need to restart after extraction. And this leads to a metaphorical and almost philosophical continuity, as we've seen in Isa. And that's a lot of it we're going to talk about. We're going to see tonight leads to a spatial continuity, a sense of openness. There's a Buddhist saying that says all things with a form will eventually break. Nothing that has a form will stay forever. And a very famous tea master, Senno Rikyo, made the tea ceremony all about this content. The tea is not but this. First you heat the water, then you make the tea, then you drink it properly. That is all you need to know. So content at the moment becomes all that matters. And that's a tea, famous tea house. And as you can see, the absence here is the reduction necessary to focus on the essential. But there's another completely different level of absence, and that's absence when absence becomes language. The word I, or me, in Japanese has 20-some possibilities to express. And there are nuances, they are gender-specific, but there are also nuances that where this multiplicity of the eyes opens up means to precise definitions of social standing, of context, of age. So I is not an absolute entity, but part in a relative framework that can change all the time. This being said, pronouns in general are hardly ever used in Japan. So preferred is the possibility of the unspoken. Preferred is the opportunity or the possibility that is in this emptiness. Where there is nothing, everything is possible. Where there is architecture, nothing else is possible. It's something very along those lines, even though what we brought out Japanese photographer, Hiroshi Sumimoto, did this series about movie theaters. And so what happens here, it takes, I'm sure a lot of you know this, but he leaves the camera shutter open for the entire length of the film. So the beauty of this image is that the entire film is on the screen. So is the film here or not? So when everything is present, nothingness is the result. So everything and nothing are in this moment the same. Or the absence is the presence of everything present. Right after the earthquake had happened in March 2011, I was approached by the Ministry of Economy and Trade Ministry. Because it was the year of the Tokyo Design Week, where I was the chief designer or something. And they said, we want to, with a small pavilion, we want to show the wealth that is hidden in Tokyo, and we want to appeal to the world that there is so much wealth, particularly talking about crafts, about materials, about arts, hidden in Tokyo that the world doesn't know, and the world now needs the support of Tokyo. So they called this exhibition Tokyo to the Future, Creating Heritage. And the entire event was about the disintegration of an assumed order, which we translated in a very small pavilion. It's only 40 by 40 meters, 196 square meters. But we let this absence disturb this assumed order, but also let this absence find new ways and new possibilities. So the opportunity lies in the in-betweens. What we did is in a small order. What we did was we used 45 by 45 millimeter freshly cut wood from the area, and just cut it in different lengths, and made a pavilion that would have the maximum allowable height of that area, which was 2.7 meters on the outside, but then gently become lower on the inside. As you walk inside, you are almost in this kind of forest of those wooden poles. And in it, there are these many like little trays where the artists and the craft or materials are displayed. And so it's a sequence of these little trays with all crafts and things from the people who visit that become part of the exhibition. And there were some other interiors, some famous visitors as well. There was the Minister of the Economy who he looks a little bit stressed because he realized that all the bodyguards around him are getting lost in those things. They try to protect him, but they cannot get through the ladder. But he's also the guy who was just months before, always on TV, in a different role, being quite silent about the nuclear meltdown that was happening. He had to explain. And so it's this space a lot about those empty betweens. The Japanese language, Japanese characters for space, they literally mean empty between. So if space is the emptiness between, architecture can be understood as a fluid, impermanent process. And I think that's a core concept of Japan's culture. Clear definitions are just one of many possible ways of perceiving the world around us. A French artist, Nicolas Lemierre, made a series of pictures of the gaps that are between the buildings in Tokyo. If you've ever been to or come to Tokyo, you can see that the buildings are about a meter apart. It's a very pragmatic thing that you're needing 50 centimeters for possible scaffolding to be able to take down your building, to maintain your building. If you build to the edge of your site, you're risking that you will not be able to sell this lot anymore because people do not buy it because they cannot tear it down. So what he did, he's just overexposing those gaps and thereby opening up the spaces that are usually too dark to see and opening up for possibilities. And some of them, actually most of them, are more like this. They're not as pristine things, but they look nice. What if architecture itself becomes a kind of disturbance of those spaces? The first project that my office completed was is the house in Takadanabara, which is also a nickname called the Foley House. It's right in the center of Tokyo. And you can see it here. It's this little thing in an urban gap. The site before looked like this. It had never been built on before. It's, it was not considered feasible to build something. The land was considered worth too much to build something of an appropriate size, and then the price dropped and it was purchased, and it's a 22 meter by 4.7 meter strip, and we came up with a concept that made full use of the site, the maximum that you can build on it. But the key to it was how to bring in light and how to make this very narrow space feel big. So what we did, as if a sheet of paper had been folded, we created more window area than surface area. Surface area is about 153, the window area about 160 square meters. And with this we're able to capture the light and make this very narrow plot feel extremely open. But this required also some structural ingenuity, and it's Masato Araya, who I got to know in 2004 when I was working at the competition in Ghent, and he did the calculations for this. Probably first world first structure, because if you think about the seismic forces, how they are absorbed here, it's almost impossible to conceive of these toothpick like columns. They're completely pin connections, as you can see, so they take no moments, that's why they can be kept so thin. They're only 8 millimeters at the bottom and here, and then they become 60 millimeters, even less on the top. There's only four of them on the top. 5 years and 6 in the morning. And how this is done is that we the structure was, the thing is that what's happening is the torsion that will be made difficult, the shear forces in the earthquake and the torsion, and that's why it's a series of reinforcement frames that go up as like the section that you saw on the construction site. And you can see there's a lot of steel going on, but every 65 centimeter, every 50 centimeter gap, and so and during construction, it looks like this. And as you can see, there's no structure in the entire space except for more than this. And this staircase was a focal point, how to bring that in. I'll talk about this later, but as you can see, the section is a very simple building. It has a lot of concrete on the bottom just to prevent it from tilting over, and the ground level, second level, and upper level is, as you can see, opening up alternately on the sides. The plan itself is actually a very Japanese concept. If you think about it, you see the entrance, and it has a very long space which can be separated by cord curtains that are not long enough to cover all the windows, but vertical, perpendicular to it. And you go up, you have a drawing room, you have a bed, So, and you will get up, you have a lounge and a kitchen in the middle and a dining area, and these open up, so it becomes an island with a terrace in these areas. The facades that nobody will ever see because they're completely next to the other buildings, like this and like this. But what happens is that this creates a very interesting sense of privacy, because if you imagine that even though these are frosted glass, windows, you would think that when you're in here that your neighbor might be able to know at least where the light is, where you are. But because you have this other level where it completely looks completely on the other side, and only this neighbor can see it, can feel where you are. We have a very strange sense of not being observed by the same person. The staircase was really interesting. It was screwed in. We only gave them 1 centimeter tolerance for the hole in the concrete, and everybody was very nervous, but it fit perfectly. And it becomes a crucial element of the house that connects these pure layers, completely separate layers, with spiral staircase. And as you can see, unbelievable amount of nature for a place in Tokyo. And this is the ground level, the back of the house. And these curtains that I was talking about, a friend of mine, a textile designer, designed them, and I told her I wanted to have a curtain that is stronger than the concrete, because the house only consists of concrete and steel and glass. And so she came up with this principle of a cocktail dress textile, which had very nice characteristics. When you do like this, it stays, it keeps its shape. And what she did was she made almost like a bag of it. So it has a very large volume, and you can use it like this and put it next to the wall. And it is actually, in a sense, it wins over the concrete. And you can see we have these series which remind of traditional Japanese uzumarinoi. So these sliding elements. And this is the second level at the end of the bed. This is what it looks like. You can get some bamboo. It's a literal backyard, because it's just one yard that's left, and that's some bamboo. And that's on the upper level, the lounge, and the dining area, which can open like this. And from the other side, from the building next door, from the roof, this tree today is almost totally taller than this whole, so this whole completely. And that's these apple maps. If you think about this concept and take it a step further, about these holes and about the continuity that they can achieve, it would be interesting if we did some studies about a wider area. So you have continuous transparent city almost, where there is no inside and no outside. So all of these would be installed structures with different heights, but they would have these traditionally, or you would become accustomed to these gaps, but they would accept them, but you feel much larger. There was this project started in the same year as the one I just showed you, and finished a little bit later. And it's a completely different take on the idea of this absence. It's a young couple with 2 kids who approached me, and they bought a huge piece of land, about over 3,000 square meters, but only 200 of those square meters are flat. The rest is at a 30-degree angle, so almost impossible to walk in. And what I what we suggested was to look at this opportunity as well, they have beautiful views, this is looking here. And we did a soil examination and found out that no matter what we would do, we would have to have a tie-in that goes down a few gave us the idea to actually dig out that land and place some very simple volumes in it. And with these volumes, create something more important than these volumes, which is space in between. So we gave them a lot more horizontal area, which they wanted, and at the same time we connected the mountain with the sea through this gesture. So the essence of the house is really this void in between. And as you approach, you're already reminded that these volumes are just a small stop on the way between mountain and sea. And if you look at this lower level, which you can see the excavated this cave-like area, which becomes the core of the house, which is the spa area. And it looks something like this. With some amazing views. And at the back of the house, we were not allowed to make any large windows, so we came up with small openings, and this became the most interesting room of the bedrooms in the guest room. And we have these big reminders and this mountain behind you. And very similar status to what we've just seen, but we have different structural engineers here. This was Arab, and they said the first one we made of 6 millimeter steel, so they wanted to be less than that, and we have 4.2 millimeter steel. And it's the same concept. And then you go up, and you have these kind of views, and on the terrace of the roof of the lower level, you have a huge terrace. A competition that we did really just by next year, which deals with again this issue of emptiness, is close to that building that I just showed you. It's a small town, and they did a competition for a traditional performing arts center, and it was the location was just right outside of the town, but facing a mountain. And the traditional performing arts in Japan are mostly mobile, but a couple of people and also some others. And Mo especially has a very strong relationship with the spiritual or the Shinto gods. And they are in the mountains, so the proximity to the mountains is really important. So we created a gesture that would connect this, the town with the mountain, and almost become a filter. But Noah is all about very simple movements. So we wanted to let this simple movement become the entire structure of the building. So literally just have a roof that folds over and is a welcome gesture. You come here from the town, filters you, and opens up to the mountain. And the plan is just and this becomes the audience sitting with the stages. So it's a very simple structure would be a place where the temporary occupation by content becomes the most important thing. So the architecture is really just framing that. In the back, already facing all the parts of that. And this kind of the temporary occupation by content is a fundamental principle of Japanese architecture. In the early 1900s, Bruno Taut discovers, so to speak, Katsura Rikyu and brings it back as the holy grail of architecture to the early Harvard's. Says, you know, it's what we've been done, this is what we've been looking for. And later, Kenzo Tange takes pictures of it, and it's really
is the architectural floor.
So the horizontality at which generates spaces of non-hierarchical organization. And therefore creates this kind of very free-flowing engaging with the surrounding nature. So architecture is part of the surrounding nature. It actually gives the nature. Now this is 1614 to 1658. If you go a little bit later, you see what happened at that time in Europe. So it's, yeah, it's almost inconceivable that on the same planet, these kind of extreme differences should happen. So you have absolutism, where humans think they are the they can impose their order on nature. And so there's another way to compare this, and this is this adaptive formation that happens in Japanese culture. Yoshinobu Ashiya wrote a very good book, it's called The Hidden Order, where he compares Tokyo with Paris. Japanese architecture gives priority to content. Content evolves in response to change, but form, once determined, is hard to alter. Think about the kimono versus the corset, where the corset restrains the body into an idealized a priori form. The kimono wraps the body as it is, accepts it as it is, becomes part of the body in the process of adaptive formation. Yeah, and for those of you wondering, there were corsets for men as well. But if you translate that to what happened in Paris, Osman is, what is he doing to, how has he transformed Paris? He has obliterated it. It's a completely different, the Paris that we know today, and most of us admire, or love even, it is a obliterated version of the medieval Paris. It's quite brutal. And it looks like this today, but in a very similar way, if another obliteration had taken place, it could look like this today. This is where you probably see it. And so, of course, there are many examples like this in the world. This is Barcelona, Cerda Street. But even Tokyo had an idea in 1887 to impose a very weird and strange order. And it's the title of this says, let's make Tokyo like Paris. The plan was by two German architects, Emil and Bergmann, who finally got to do one building, nothing else but one building, and this building still stands today. But they were the only time that this Cartesian order is imposed on Tokyo by a Japanese architect. It happens on water. And as the metabolists in the 1960s, this came to the family himself, but there are several proposals for this, all dealing with the water, Tokyo Bay. So the most intriguing part of these plans happens at the transition between the rigid, the land, and the fluid, and the sea. And one of the most influential architects of the 20th century, Japanese architects of the 20th century, Sasaki, who's still alive, wrote in 1962 when he was 30 something. Such city planning has always ended in empty theory, and that is why cities have been kept alive. So it's a highly critical stance already at the time when these proposals are turned out. The reason for the impossibility of imposing a rigid grid like this is the acceptance of topography. This is a map of Tokyo 10,000 years ago with superimposed Tokyo like it looks today. You can see that a lot of it is now land. Most of it actually became land naturally, but a lot of it here is reclaimed. This is Shinagawa, this is Tokyo Station, and so on and so on. What you can also see is these valleys, riverbeds, which turn out to be extremely bad during the 1923 earthquake, which is where most destruction happens, just because the land is not as stable. But it also is a blueprint for the sewage. This is the clean water system and the sewage system, which follows these natural technologies. If Descartes did not know how to get through the labyrinth, it was because he saw the secret in continuity of continuity in rectilinear tracks. And this is exactly Tokyo's infrastructure does not see the rectilinear tracks. And this is the fundamental flaw that urban planners who have been trying to impose on Tokyo with this kind of rectilinear system. Because Tokyo is, the reality of Tokyo is like this. And all of a sudden, we're deep in Tokyo and there is this emptiness, this is the imperial palace. So there's an empty sentiment. And if we look at the top, that's the Western idea of space. The church is in the middle, the tower is around it. The Japanese idea is that it's a shrine, it has several of those gates, and it's definitely not on the top, it's just part of the system. At the same time, if you think about these kind of interpretations of space, you start thinking that, like an onion, you start peeling it, it's layer after layer after layer, but there's no core, there's no necessity to look for a core. And Roland Barthes, who wrote a book called The Empire of Science, which I can also recommend to understand Tokyo or Japanese culture from a Western point of view. No Japanese dish is endowed with a center. Food is never anything but a collection of fragments, none of which appears privileged by an order of industry. And Tokyo is really this kind of city without organs. The analogy of amoeba is from Ashihara's book, where if you think about the amoeba, it changes all time, all its parts change, and it keeps its integrity. So if you go to Tokyo in 5 years, you may not find the same houses that you saw 5 years before, but you understand it's still the same city. If you destroy, if you rebuild a lot of Paris, for example, you don't recognize it anymore. So this permanent transition, or the problem with permanent transition is context. It's a really different idea of what context is. If you grow up in this Western culture, it's completely different. So we did a building in Yomogi, in the middle of Tokyo. And we had the opportunity to understand and deal with this context, which is a completely eclectic ensemble of things. And this is my favorite picture of this building, because it doesn't stand out. What it does, it uses a simple mechanism, which is the square, to order, play with this eclectic context, and give it some kind of order, but at the same time become one of it. And it's really about the relationship of these surroundings, and are we wrapping the context, or is the context wrapping us? So the inside and the outside are kind of, the outside is filtered in the inside. And it's always the other parts that's happening from the inside. And a year later, the same client bought a land in Kyoto. Kyoto is not a Japanese city. Yeah? It's a Chinese border. As you can see, there's only a few cities in Japan that have this kind of very weird, for Japanese, kind of weird system of grid superimposing. And it is in the center of Kyoto, which in the 1960s looked like this. And it still is along the white lines, the picture that I just showed you. And it still today looks essentially like this. But what happened on the red line of our site is that they lifted the regulations and everything was possible. So the context, the images on the along the white pattern are like this still today. On the other side, something like this happened. So they lifted the height regulations and now it's 15 meters. And what happened is that we were given the opportunity to set the precedence of context because they are now reintroducing stricter building regulations. So it's a quite interesting take to, if you think there is no context, but there will be context in the future, and it would be the first building to do that. So we looked at this labyrinth, this horizontal labyrinth, and translated it into the vertical because the client wanted to create a bar, a gallery, a boat, and we looked at these images, and it was so fascinating because this might be a very expensive restaurant, there might be a super cheap place, there might be a brothel, there might be, it's really full of surprises. And we said, well, let's do the same thing and make it one building that has the experience of the surprises and of the adventure in the vertical. And the first thing that we told the client is we cannot have an elevator. Usually we have a 15 meter tall building that will have 4 or 5 stories, and you have an elevator, and then you need an emergency staircase, and the plot was only 50 square meters. So what happens is that you're left with 4 or 5 levels of unusable space. And we said, let's turn the divided levels into one continuous experience. And we said, let's make the staircase larger than it needs to be for regulation, because then it becomes another space. And the last thing we said, let's put the staircase in the middle. So this is what happened. And the client was a really good client, we followed with this idea. So we built a space, a gallery, or a bar around staircases. We suspended the staircase from steel boards, which doubled up as railings, and then the floor levels just branch out at these levels. And as you can see, pull up. So what happens is when you enter the building here, this is at this level, there's a few steps down into the kitchen, so you see the action going on. A few steps up is the first bar, counter, and you go up again, you see something. So by the moment you go up one, you want to go up again and again. And so your evening unfolds in a sequence of being drawn into ever deeper into the building. The interior elevation is like this, and the street faces the west, and this was the crucial facade because it was completely open to bring in light, but also to filter the outside and the inside, and the east only the top was open, and the rest was there was a building behind. So in order to keep this kind of adventure, this kind of suspension, we looked at the traditional ways of louvers that have dominated the architecture around Kyoto and the wider area for centuries. And there's a very intricate system of these louvers. They relate to social standing, or let's say the purpose of the shop, the location obviously, the purpose of the building, could be shop, could be private, etc. And they give different depth and different openings. And so we looked at these and we said, we need to make the building, we need to make it dense, because it's a quite a 15 meter prison. It's 4 meters wide, so 5 meters wide, 15 meters tall, so we need to have a presence that is not as dominating. So we started to rotate those louvers, and since they are 50 meters, we divide the facade in several levels and change the center of rotation coming up, which then, this is a detail, this is what you are mentioning, the detail prize was awarded for this building, but the jury comment for a magazine that is about details, and then the jury goes, that this building reduces the details to a point where they disappear. It's a very nice comment. I thought it was interesting for this detailed prize. So the facade would look like this if you just keep the louvers straight, but if you start rotating them, to get the hard definition of the edges is a view. And if you walk by, the building really starts to dance because it changes. And this is the actually built result. We have these steel. They're all welded at a precise angle, and then we have the Hinoki's Japanese cypress louvers, about close to 500 of them, that change from a solid looking wall to a very open transitions, as you can see. And that's on the top, looking to the other side, where you can see what you can see there. So what this does is creates a transition from, or a moving away from the absolute to the relative. And this is the first project that my office did. It's actually started with a client who was a Lehman Brothers employee, and he lost his job and then disappeared, but the project continued because I didn't have any projects in the first year of the CC office because they all disappeared because of the Lehman shop. So we worked out a few of them, and this is this house in Karuizawa where the brief was. Summer residents, 40 minutes outside of Tokyo, and the brief was, we live in Tokyo, we live in a concrete environment, when we go there, all we want to see is green. So we opened up a house that would let the green inside, literally let it inside, and made a structure where every finger of those would become a movement. Approach here, you hardly see the building, and then you go down slowly, and then the building opens up. You enter the building, and there's a guest room, and then a dining room, kitchen building, and so on. So the outside really becomes smaller than inside. And shortly after that, we were commissioned by one of Malaysia's largest developers to come up with a concept for the luxury condominium in the tropics, but it should be low-rise, as low-rise as possible. And we, with the usual responses towers associated with luxury, and we focus on the true luxury of the tropics, which is that you can actually, people have for centuries lived there without worrying too much about air conditioning. But the key is to use the sun, or to shade from the sun, and to use stories each, so it's 15 stories. And the total floor area is about 100,000 square meters, 500 units. But as you can see, it's a very, it's very thin, but it's also pretty shade, and it creates only a maximum of so many hours per day of sun exposure, no matter where you are. And the building was further in green forests, so these green pockets are all ventilated lobbies where you come up and you don't go into a dark room, but you are part of immediately inside a garden before you step into your house. So the air goes through. And so the building entirely would work as a mechanism, as a plant, so to speak. It's not only from the sustainability point of view, but also structurally, that the logic becomes, that drives the process of the building. And we finally came up after several iterations, just a few of them, as they are fine-tuning, and then this concept where the building really starts to breathe and becomes like a large plant with extremely comfortable breathing areas. Unfortunately, when I went to present the building, the board of directors, some of them, the one who had to say so, was not informed that we had to do a low-rise study. And he asked me, so why didn't you do it? This is a house that's currently under construction, which will be finished next year. It's a family, a large family who bought a 2.7 hectare, 27,000 square meter public land in the middle of the forest. And when they go there, they want to be amongst the trees. They want to have, they want to be together as a family, but at the same time be able to have places where they can not see the family all the time. It's a family, it's a holiday home. But so what we came up with, several concepts actually, but eventually went through and became the project is the idea that it's a very a house that actually finds its ways in the openings in the forest, expansion through the existing trees. So we had 70 trees of the area. Once we were sure where roughly where we were going to build, we had 70 of those trees mapped in order to keep as many as possible of them and place the house is really branching through those existing trees so that the trees become part of the experience. The structure is quite simple, a little bit more complex than this, but the principle is that it's a wooden frame structure or a concrete plate, so that at the end of those branches they cut off and they become these windows, these openings into the forest. We did an analysis of the exact opposites, how much the difference between public and private within that house. So, I mean, which is not obvious, but along the spines where if we open all of these partitions, then this is where the most public space and the further you go to these extremes, the more privacy you have. So at the end of the building, it's like this, and you can already feel you walking, actually you're stepping into the forest. And this is where we just came into the entrance, and this is the living area, the dining area, and this is a way towards the bedroom, common bedroom, and this is a study area. You look into the forest, actually you're sitting in the forest. And that was taken last week. We did this last year to get the precise system. Now we're doing it in order to to just quickly run over this project, which is again about the importance of the relative of, versus the absolute. This was a competition for an island kingdom, which is part of Taiwan, but actually very close to mainland China. And it has been the center of dispute for many years. There really always is there going to be a military conflict or not? Very close, a lot of times. But recently, it's become something much more effective in terms of approaching each other, which is trade, which is this island is a duty-free island. So we had to, the competition was about a ferry porter, because of mainland Chinese go there to purchase duty-free items or to go to a casino. And what we wanted to create is a ferry terminal where that is neither on the land nor on the sea, you're in a state in between. So when you don't know how you already arrived, you're still on the ship. To create this kind of deliberately create this kind of sense of uncertainty. So what we did was we just used a plate and made some incisions and started to do it gently to let in light but also air and create this landscape that is between the sea and simple gesture which achieves a lot of the program and also creates this extremely strange space of in between. We come back to Tokyo and a little bit of the history of Tokyo. The defining period was the time of the Japanese bubble, which had its peak in 1989. And if you look at Japan and compare it to the world, you see this kind of very strange thing here, which is between 1986 and 1991, Japan is worth more than the rest of the world. Speculative figure, but if an alien had come and said, I want to buy the earth, how much is it? And then you'd say, 100, no, that's too much, I only have 60, what can I buy? Yeah, you can buy Japan, or you can have a person for 40. That kind of absolutely absurd idea, so where Tokyo becomes, in retrospect, becomes the ultimate city of the capital of growth. In the hand of the globe's in the hand of and what happens is that architecture becomes a liability for yourself. So everything that is possible, because money was everywhere from and everyone created these kind of very strange things. This is by Kenbukuma, I'm sure a lot of you know. Before he was once kicked out and came back to Tokyo. And this building was constructed in 1991 for, and that's just a figure that is not historically adjusted, but if we just say it's $25 billion. And in 2002, 11 years later, it was sold, including the land, for $10 billion, and renovated for $5 billion. What was originally a research center for Latsa is now a, or became a funeral home. Another building along those lines is bydevising, which we've guessed it, and that was built in 1992 for, again, $25 million, and it was sold for $4 million, including the land, and the renovation cost was $5 million. And today, it is this beautiful gem of architecture. It's a home for elderly as a senior nursing home. And if you don't believe me, that's, I mean, at least it's 2050, so we can go back and convince it's still standing like this. So at this time, what happens is that money is really driving this engine that is Tokyo crazy. All of the big contractors, they're starting to propose things that are outrageous. Just to put this in perspective, this is Mount Fuji, 3,700 and some meters, and this is Tokyo Tower, which was built in 1958, 330 meters. Yeah. Today it looks like this. At the time it was the only tall building around. And the Roppongi Hills, built in 2003. Yeah, another sky tree, 600 meters, finished recently. Yeah, and now you see that these are built projects, and you're looking at unbuilt projects that were planned, meticulously planned around this year, plus minus. And Kajima is one of the big construction companies. They built the DIE 200, which was 800 meters tall, when they planned it, and had 200 floors. That's at the height of the bubble. Right? It doesn't stop there. Takinaka, we have 1,000 meters, 35,000 inhabitants in this building. And these are all proposals that are not just drawn by students at some semester assignment. There are hundreds of people working on this. They are engineered and they are feasible, and etc. In 2001 meters by Obayashi, and that's Aeropolis with 500 floors. And it would have looked like this. And Shimizu, Darth Vader among the construction companies, is the pyramid megacity. And for some reason, I don't know, nobody told them, they were probably in the pyramid, nobody told them the bubble was already gone. But they built this, and it's 2,004 meters, 100 floors, 750,000 inhabitants. But in order to chop it all, Taisei, who are now building the Olympic Stadium, they went and proposed the only building taller than Mount Fuji, 4,000 meters, 800 floors, 1 million people, and it would have taken 30 years. So it would be finished next year. Yes. These things, if you think about it, there was a time when this was thought feasible. And I think we can all agree that luckily they have not been realized, but some have, and more and more are being realized, where we are on the verge of having enough of an impact that will actually transform a city even as Tokyo. Or I believe that Tokyo is strong enough to overcome things like this. There's a strong thing about Tokyo, and that's the reason why I believe we overcome it. It has this positive urban amnesia. Whereas Mola says it's a critical part of our repertoire of construction that enables us to efficiently recycle each mistake, each crime, each stupidity that it imagines it is supposed to. And it's mostly referring to Roppongi Hills and other buildings like that, which become a permanent house of horror for all, and the strongest building is permanent because they are now they are buildings that are really trying to get rid of this positive transformation that we're trying to describe. And it's the same thing with this sky tree and so on. But the same mentioned in the introduction, this was the 2016 proposal when Tokyo tried to get the Olympics in 2016. They used the existing stadium, which is a beautiful stadium, and for some reasons, 4 years later, it didn't make it in 2016 in Rio. They applied again, and they had a competition. They thought that we have to have a competition, and the criterion to apply for the competition to take part was that you had to have a Riva gold medal or a Pritzker prize or a stadium of so and so many seats in the river. So you can see where it goes, where this goes to. It's a flashy experiment, etc. I thought Toyo was much more mature than this. But didn't stop there, Zahir got cancelled, and now we're looking at something like this, which has the appropriate name of the hamburger. I don't want to know all the scandal things that really got me mad, but the reason why I did the alternative proposal was because I was very, very mad and enraged about this entire process and the mediocre result that we ended up with. So I looked at it and I thought, well, what, you know, since we've already cancelled the statement, what if it gets cancelled again? And isn't that the more likely outcome? So we devised a project that actually happens. So the vehicle to transport this is a package from the future, from 2020 to be precise, which we my office received mysteriously, where all these documents, this is an economist from 2020, this is the timeout from 2020, so obviously it happened. It was reality, so it was published, right? So we got this package, and dealing with a hopefully positive outcome of the Olympics. And I believe that, I assume that something like this could have been a much more meaningful contribution to this entire white elephant story that is in the Olympics today. But as we know, we'll probably sit in the hour and see. So, then to come to the end, I think Toyo has always been the city of the future. And if you just look at this image, this is from 1972, Solaris, Tarkovsky goes to Tokyo and finds the city of the future right there. He doesn't need to make any expensive scenery for his movie. He just rents a car and drives through the city. This is the opening scene. If you haven't seen the movie, you have to see it. And it's so, for me, it's so mind-boggling to see this. And still, if it weren't for the cars do it a little bit older. And you can still feel that this, even today, looks like a very futuristic city. But we have to put it in a very interesting context. This is the first skyscraper that was built in 1968. There was a height limit in Tokyo of 31 meters, and then technology caught up, and it was feasible to build the skyscrapers that are earthquake-proof. This is the Kasumiya City building, which is 156 meters, 36 stories tall. And it was finished in 1968, and shortly after that, a very interesting article that addressed the issue of, well, now we have all of a sudden we have 10,000 people in the building, what if they all come in their own car? And I think this is such a beautiful, pragmatic response by a newspaper. And all of a sudden, this necessity of something, some kind of presence, in this case a car park, where do we put all the cars and people that go there, suggests some kind of absence around this building. And so if architecture remains a field where this kind of reality is met with a mix of humor and pragmatism, I think we are on the right track. But the real future issue that is coming now is that the population of Tokyo is dwindling. Yeah, next year is supposed to be the peak of the population, and what will happen is a completely new sense of, a new kind of absence, very literal absence of humans that will
issue for
not only for architects but for society. If you look at it, yeah, the population of 65 and above right now is between every fourth and fifth person in Tokyo is already 65 or above. And in 2100, it will be every second person. We will not be part of that, we will be gone by then, I think, some of us. But the good news here on this side is that we have some exceptional senior nursing homes. And as a matter of fact, crucially, I think we're really beginning to see a new kind of absence. And this is an absence which will decisively impact the physical space. And it's starting here in what is now known to be the first world. And Germany is one of those countries that will have to deal with it. And architects will have to deal with it in a very interesting way. And perhaps learning from a culture, but what I'm trying to, do for 15 years, which is embracing this kind of opportunity that lies in this transitoriness, in the belief and the impermanence, and the very fast evolutionary cycles that come with it. This may make us well equipped for this kind of change in the future. I will see. So I'm going to stop here.
Is there a difference in our Japanese way
perhaps your level of approaching this. And of course, that doesn't mean that you don't do the program. It just doesn't seem to fit you as an actor.
Absolutely, that like I very much deliberately left the lecture like this because I did not want everybody to equate programs or content with programming. Because I think it's what I'm trying to say is the difference between the form and the content is much wider than that. And I think that's something I'm learning is the right word for it. I'm thinking about on a daily basis. Of course, I could have shown you a lot of diagrams to show you the program, but not today because I think what I'm trying to show you with this absence, or the presence of absence, is immediately triggering a lot of more, a wider a range of content and programs.
This idea of spatial repatriating that you spoke about, do you necessarily equate it to the idea of surface repatriating in the form? Is there that kind of a relation?
You mean the single surface architecture?
Yeah, because I find somehow most of the projects dealing with this single surface in a very operative way, cutting in.
Yes, I mean, I think single surface architecture is definitely one very interesting approach to that. But it's not, if you think that you're solving continuity with the single surface architecture, I think you're in a completely huge trap. Mm-hmm. Because I think the very opposite is true. With single surface architecture, you're more creating discontinuity. The problem where the program no longer fits, and then you're creating the single service architecture for its own purpose, and I think then it becomes really uninteresting, or to say the least. But if you have a beautiful single service architecture, you can have a spatial continuity, but you have spatial continuity in many ways.
I refer to the spatial continuity aspect as for example, the idea that you set out that you cannot wait and then putting the first thing that you put in is the rice storage.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the continuity of history because I see that you show so much about moments within Japan and within Tokyo, the very precise moments of history and how you are at the same time drawing parallels of how your architecture is making these precise kind of interventions in research. But like I said, I rate all of them as these kind of single service architecture being introduced at different at all times in history, the same single surface kind of architecture is being reintroduced in different ways, manifests for me differently. So how I read it. So that's why I asked that is that what you're talking about when you're reading the continuity aspect across history? I'm not sure if I'm getting through to you.
I'm not. I was sure until. But are you saying that single surface architecture at different points of history is about continuity?
No, I'm saying, do you think of it like that? Because I see the solution,
yes.
Or your response,
yes.
To the certain history and within a certain time period within which you intervene is a different type of form of single service.
But not always. I mean, I chose some projects. I could have shown you much more about single service architecture in the work, but I didn't deliberately choose some other projects as well. I think the continuity is a much bigger thing than whether it's happening on the surface or not.
I really enjoyed the lecture to start with. I was wondering, I mean, this idea about the Japanese culture being a culture of extremes, I could also see that there's a kind of extreme contradiction between the idea of this constant renewal and then the application of this modernist technology. And when it comes to architecture, one could also question that the technology that is used is not something that is in itself renewable, and it's not something that is sustainable, but it's a kind of modernist view of, you know, you're building yourself, building better technology, and then you solve the problem that you've created. And somehow I was wondering, is there any idea of translating this idea of the constant renewal in Japanese culture into something like a circular economy, or something that is kind of less relying on modernist, non-sustainable technology?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, two things. What I was trying to show with the last images, the bubble years, but also after that, and all these kind of things. I think it's a false sustainability, because they are buildings that are supposed to stand forever, which is extremely antithetical to what Japan has been doing, I think. And so the other side, the sustainability is on a completely different level of thinking than what you would be used to here. And I'm really not sure, but I'm sure that there are some fundamental mistakes being made in growth. And one main criticism that I would have here is that we are isolating ourselves from the environment. We never think of insulation layers. Is that really sustainable?
No, I mean, that's the Japanese approach.
Yes, but that's why we're getting, trying to get at. The same thing is, there's a trend towards that that's happening in but the average life of a small house in Tokyo is still only 26 years. It's not because they wouldn't be able to keep them longer or be able to build it for longer, but the entire mentality is different. That you would not, I think the architecture is a little bit more than an extension of your clothing, rather than something that the great guy, will bequeath upon my children and their children and their children. And so this idea doesn't exist. It's rather, who am I to propose a house for my children? They would want something completely different. And there are other reasons, and that's very polemic to express now, that one of them is very happy that the inheritance taxes are very expensive. But still, that the idea that we build something for 100 years or for even longer is still not so part of the I think of the Japanese mentality as it would be here. Does that answer the question?
It would extend the question in an interesting way.
Are you discussing life cycles of your clients?
Sorry?
Are you discussing the life cycles of your buildings with your clients? Are they telling you, I want to live here for 5 days?
No. That's interesting because also when private clients for smaller buildings, when they approach an architect, they have a different, they believe that they will love what they will get. So there's a completely different mindset. But if the average person purchases a house, he would not go, or she would not go to an architect. They would go to a so-called housemaker, and my language, but a very shitty piece of building that when you open the door, it's like a car, 50% of the value is gone in this very moment. Yeah, seriously. And but it's built for average 26 years. So if you, to come back to your questions, if I'm or when I'm approached, it's not on the agenda because it's taken for granted that they will actually keep it as something that is, maybe yeah, they will destroy it. I mean, if you think one of the most beautiful buildings when I was a student, one of the most beautiful experiences that happened reading through a building was actually the White Jew by Toyo Ito. You think he builds a building for his sister and he is in charge to dismantle it again after the sister decides that she can no longer live there for bigger reasons. But also because of the life that was in that building could not be shared with somebody else.
I was very moved. I really enjoyed your lecture, and I thought you are really interested in observing the many society. And I would like to ask about the movement of young Japanese architect. I saw many news about this type of generation after the bubble. They don't have any kind of desire. So in architect scene, is there any particular movement of young architects in Japan, or there's nothing special?
There's a lot of special that I'm sure you're aware of. I mean, how young do you mean?
29 years old.
What kind of, how young would you say the young generation of Japanese architects?
I'm not sure, but for instance, I saw the magazine AU.
Yeah.
There was about the young American architects.
And AU is only focusing on non-Japanese.
I know that. What I mean is that, so there's a young American architect. They said specific kind of generation, it's a young generation. Yeah. So I'm not sure which kind of age is young generation, but around 30
or 40. What I'm observing, to be very honest with you, is maybe Ishigami is like plus minus around then, which is a very, of course, successful and famous generation. Fujimoto is a little bit older, Fujimoto is a little bit older than I am, Ishigami is a little bit younger than I am. And then there's the next generation coming. And what I've observed, and I hope I'm wrong, but there's a strange tendency towards non-adventure. And so I'm observing that, but I'm not sure. I hope I'm wrong. But if that was where you're going, what is the young generation of that? Is that if that's, I'm missing adventure. And I'm missing that when people apply in the office. I'm missing that.
This is how to do.
So, the message for you, be adventurous. Seriously, I'm really, really, that's...
I want to know, like, in your opinion, what do you think is like the main difference in the design process in Japanese architecture office in comparison with European?
I might not be the right person to ask because I have less experience with European offices. I was working with European offices from design architect versus local architect, but then it's a different relationship. There is no Japanese office. There is no European office. I think they are so different in themselves. If I can talk to you about my memories of Ito extremely interesting team process where a lot of proposals are put on the table, a lot of engineers are part of the team. I think we found very, very similar approaches all over the world in this kind of caliber offices. And maybe coming back to the absence in the outreach is something that really fascinated me into the office. So we were in meetings and there were sometimes 5 minute pauses. But a lot was probably the most important parts were decided in these 5 minutes. And a lot of times everybody walks out with a different opinion. And it's this might be the start of a very creative process. Do you want to say?
Well, thank you so much.